You're watching the PBS NewsHour. I'm Hari Sreenivasan. Thank you for joining us for a Google Hangout. The recent events in Ferguson have a lot of people wondering about use of force by local police and authorities. And for this conversation, we're joined by Dr. Tracie Keesee. She is a 25-year veteran of the Denver Police Department and also has a PhD in intercultural communication from the University of Denver. So I want to ask, how do police departments codify what is necessary or appropriate or excessive use of force by their officers when they're thinking about setting down policy that all the officers have to obey?
Force, I should say all use of force policy is codified by law. It's going to vary from state to state, but they're typically pretty in line. And what happens is as the officers go through their training, the academy, they learn exactly what is, you know, the appropriate use of force according to law, and also how to apply that force. So you have multiple things going on. You have sort of what we call a law class, and then you'll have a practical portion of that as well.
And so when they're in these courses, I'm assuming that they're learning that there's obviously very different kinds of forces. I mean, we're all conscious of physical force, but there's also chemical force in the form of pepper spray, and there's, I guess, electronic force from tasers, and maybe even just kind of impact and then ultimately firearms. So, you know, the problem, I guess, one of the things that people point out is that there's a level of subjectivity of an officer's maybe instinct or decision-making process. So how do you train someone to think rationally in times when an officer most likely is under stress, maybe feeling under threat?
Well, I mean, part of that is you take them through scenario-based training. And so when you're teaching how to use force, or what we would call how to effect an arrest, you're going through these different scenarios. And as trainers and as, you know, as a recruit myself, you're learning not only how to apply the law, but what's the appropriate level of force for what situation. So in a lot of cases, when an officer engages in any level of force of those that you described, it's going to depend on that situation and the officer's perspective of what's happening.
So, I mean, you know, in the legal test, it's usually of excessive force. It kind of determines, I guess a judge or a jury would determine whether the police officer reasonably believed that such force was necessary. So, but there's not really a universal definition of what's reasonable.
And the reason why there isn't is that reasonableness is up to the officer. It's the individual officer that is engaged in that. And that is the reasonable definition of most of those legal pieces is the experience of the officer at the time they're going through that event.
You know, there was a scene that played out in St. Louis a few days ago, and it was caught on cell phone camera. There was a man apparently wielding a knife and approaching officers. And you know, they shot and killed him when he got within a certain distance. And I think this also makes people ask, isn't there an intermediate step? You know, could we go to something else like tasers or pepper spray before already proceeding to that point where we're drawing our weapon?
Well, you know, and again, as we were talking about training, that is the perception of the officer that is engaged. And most, in all of court of law, that conversation that you're going to have hang out and the additional shooting that they had is what was the officer experiencing at the time, and did they believe that they were in imminent danger? So, you know, are there other tools available? Of course there are, and I think we all know that. But again, the decision on which tool to use and which one is appropriate is left up to the officer during that event.
Do officers have an option of what weapons they choose to carry versus what's required of them by different departments?
Well, it varies from department to department. So some will mandate, for example, that you carry a taser, so when you leave, you have a taser with you in addition to your weapon. Others can't afford tasers, so you may not. So you may rely on pepper spray, and you may rely on, you know, beanbag guns, those types of things, or whatever may stun someone. But those are really, it varies across the United States, and it varies from department to department.
And what about the in levels of training in dealing with different kinds of confrontations? Even let's say a weapon is the only choice that you have left. How do you train someone to immobilize their opponent or attacker versus to kill them? I mean, in some of these videos, et cetera, you see people taking multiple shots, and there's just, you know, after you hear seven shots ring out, you don't think that it's they're not all shooting at his leg. You know, I mean, obviously, I'm not in the position of the officer. I'm not in the position of the attacker, et cetera. I wasn't there. But is there kind of a baseline training that says if you have to do it, slow them down or do something to stop them, but maybe not to kill them?
Well, you know, I think that's part of the discussion that will be happening post-Ferguson. And the training for firearms varies across departments. But typically, if you are using the level of force, and that is of your weapon, it is not trained to shoot to maim like you see on television shows. It is a use of deadly force. That's why it's called deadly force. And I think what you would like to have ideally happen is have a really well-trained officer will assess the situation and make those decisions using their training. But again, these types of incidents happen in seconds. And so what you're doing is you're asking the officer to make all of these assessments within seconds. And it's, again, it goes back to what is that individual officer experiencing at the time.
What are the departments you're working with, what are the other folks that you know in the industry thinking about now, watching Ferguson play out night after night?
Well, you know, it's interesting. You know, we have these conversations about, one, what will policing look like post-Ferguson? Will the rules of engagement and how you engage with the First Amendment rights, are we doing all the things that we should be doing as law enforcement officers to protect that ability to express yourself? So, I mean, most likely, I mean, we watch this occur over Rodney King. You know, we watch it happen post 9/11. So there's always what we call these moments in time with law enforcement where you reassess and you make decisions about whether or not these are the best ways to approach. We always watch other departments. It's learning. These are learning opportunities for everyone involved in law enforcement. So there'll be a lot of discussion, not just, you know, in Ferguson, but those neighboring counties and in those departments throughout the United States.
So after these moments where there are opportunities to learn, what changes? Why do we regress? Why do we see this pattern repeat itself?
Well, I mean, I think we're talking about the shooting of unarmed black men. I mean, that pattern is something that, you know, the CPE that I belong to that we're studying. I mean, why do these things keep reoccurring, especially in this day and age? And we talk about training and selecting the best officers and, you know, and cultural competency training. Why aren't these things having an impact? And I think that's going to be probably the number one question that everyone is going to try to get to the bottom. But when it comes to tactics, and that's what you were seeing over the last 12 days as far as, you know, officers in riot gear and those types of things, those are always assessed. And it really depends on the size of the department and how those types of events. So there's a lot of factors that come into play with that as well. But, you know, in some departments, you know, maybe even like Ferguson, this is the first time they've had a crowd size like this or an event where they had to manage a crowd. So, I mean, it really varies from department to department.
So when you see, for example, major cities take on and prepare for a political convention, they have a whole different set of life experiences and crowd experiences than some small town like Ferguson.
Absolutely. I mean, that is absolutely factored in. And when you look at, for example, you know, and I'll use Denver for the DNC, I mean, there was hours and months of training on how do you do these types of things and how do you engage.
All right, Dr. Tracie Keesee joining us from Denver. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
You're watching the PBS NewsHour. I'm Hari Sreenivasan. Stay with us.